Okay, so now we've published, let's switch back over to our demo app and refresh that. I'm going to go over a few little things that I kind of skipped over before. One of those is that you may have noticed that as soon as we added the workflow in, we no longer have the plus icon over here. So we cannot add tickets manually as if we're adding a database record. And in the same way, if you click on a ticket, there's no delete option. You cannot delete it or edit it either. As soon as it goes into workflow, it becomes uneditable. Now, the way that that actually happens is that it adds some flags onto the tickets type, the tickets tab, to say that it shouldn't actually be edited, it shouldn't be deleted, and it shouldn't be created. That allows the workflow to take control of the tab, without having the users going in and bypassing different stages and putting in bits of information that they shouldn't be putting in at that particular time. But of course, you can, like with everything in Workflow First, you can just revert that and put that back if you like. So if you click back on the application tab record, the tickets record, this is before we get into our workflow, so we're back on the application tab. Now you'll notice there is a tab at the bottom called flags, or a drill down called flags. If you click on that, you'll see the three flags that it actually added automatically called disallow create, disallow delete, disallow edit. You can just get rid of those if you want to allow people to actually create or delete. I'm just going to demonstrate that so I can get rid of those two records that we had in the workflow earlier that don't have any information in there. So sometimes you can do this as an administrator, so that you can then go in and fiddle some things in the workflow, maybe to migrate it from an older version to a newer version or something like that. So I'm just going to go here and delete this flag by clicking the delete icon. I see my flags again. When you delete things, you notice it actually goes back to the same as the drill down for flags, so it goes down to this view here. But you can see where you are. We're in the applications demo app, the data model, the application tab for tickets, and then we're in the flags area here. And you can add new flags by clicking plus here. Or if you're on the application tab, when you click flags down here, you can click plus right here as well, or you can just use the quick entry, which is this little line at the top here, which lets you add more flags. Anyway, we've gotten rid of the disallow delete. So let's publish that now. Now when this comes up, you know, you won't notice anything different on here, but in the drop-down menu at the end, you notice we now have a delete option, which we didn't have before. I don't want to delete this particular one. I want to actually delete these two. So I can just go delete here, click OK, and then, then delete this one, click OK here. So now we only have our record that we want. Now we want to put back that disallow delete, because we don't really want people deleting things in this. So we just go to our quick entry and flags at the bottom here, and we just select disallow delete. A lot of other flags in there that we'll be getting into at another time. Nothing you really need to worry about at this point. And we've added in delete there now, so we can then republish that. The next time we republish it, we'll see that it's no longer there. You don't actually have to necessarily have those flags put on automatically. If I go back to the application tabs and I click add workflow to create a new workflow, I will show you something. If you click on other settings here, there is an option here that says disable other editing. That's actually the option that tells it to put those three flags on. If you just set that to no, it wouldn't have put those on in the first place. I should probably go over just a few of the other things that we have in here, because it's kind of interesting. Create report is actually a report that it generates for you, which gives you a breakdown of outstanding workflow items and the stage, grouped by the stage that they're actually in. Very useful, because not only does it create that report with all the columns in there automatically, it also gives you the option of subscribing to that so that you can have it emailed to you each morning. As a PDF file that you can then look at and see which workflow actually has to be done that day, almost like a little kind of task list that you can have at the start of the day. Very useful. Another option, which is not on by default, is assignable. We could actually have used that in this case. I mean, we have a stage where we're assigning it to a technician. But that's kind of an exception. It's not always going to be assigned to someone. If you want it to always be assigned to someone, you add assignable here. And that really turns it into a task so that it can then have other options on there as well, like the state that it's in, whether it's completed or not completed, how many days are estimated to complete it. A lot of different fields to do with task or project management will be added in automatically if you set that to yes. Another option which is on, audit trail, we've showed that already. That just keeps a record of everything that changes on the record. Show buttons, this is just whether we see the buttons on the screen or whether the options for the workflow are hidden in the what's next menu instead. It's best actually to have them as buttons most of the time. This tab only means that it allows the workflow to only be started on this particular tab. If you had lots of application tabs, you may want it to be started on any of the tabs, so you set that to no. Condition, we don't need to go into now, but that's a condition that will indicate whether or not the workflow can start. You can have different conditions in the system that say, you know, it's not ready to start, so you put that in there. Disable other editing we mentioned. Add originator as the originator field. You don't have to have that on there if you don't want to. Notify originator is actually another great, very useful option. This sends out an email to you automatically to tell you whenever the workflow changes, whenever it goes from one stage to another, to different people. It'll send you an email detailing exactly what has changed in the record. Add notification by stage. Notifications is something we'll get into in another video. That's basically an area where you can subscribe to different things that happen, different notifications to do with this workflow. In this case, it adds something that you can subscribe to by stage. So I can say whenever it goes to an escalate stage, I want to be notified by it. I want to get an email whenever it's assigned to a technician. And then I can say I want to get an email whenever it's assigned to a technician, and that technician is me, because it allows you to put filters in there as well. So that's incredibly useful, especially with a lot of workflow with a lot of different roles and stages. Notification by role is the same idea, but it actually allows you to subscribe to a particular role. So anything to do with a CSO role, I will be notified about. Add filters by role. Now, to show you what I mean by filters, I should switch back to the application so you can see it. Next to tickets, we see this little drop down here that's blank. We can also select CSO or tech, and that will actually filter the list to show me only the things that are related to CSO or only the things related to a tech. When you're an admin, that's actually very useful. So we have that on by default, but you can turn it off if you don't like it. The Add My Workflow Only role. I've told you a bit about roles before. We create security roles during the workflow for different types of people, CSO, tech. There are other roles that it adds in, which actually add as kind of filters. The My Workflow Only, in this case is going to be My Ticket Workflow Only, will be a role that you can add to a user that will make it so that they can only see their own workflow items. They cannot see other people's workflow items. So it actually adds a filter on there based on the originator field. So it's impossible for you to access someone else's workflow. When you click on the tickets, you will only see the tickets that you started and that are being worked on for you. Very important, especially for things like help desk applications, because you don't want other people seeing other people's tickets necessarily. You know, you just want people to be looking at what they've raised and the status of that. Again, you need to make sure that you add that to the user, though, so they only see that. It won't be added automatically, although you can actually change it. So it can be added automatically, but we'll get to that later. Add messaging. Now, you may have noticed whenever you, if I switch back to the application here, this one is finished, but if I just enter something else in here quickly, my window is stuck. I cannot open my window. Something random like that. So if I click on this here, now you'll notice that as well as the three options that we talked about earlier, it also adds a query option. That is what gets added if we have the add messaging option on, set to yes. And what that does is that it actually sends a query back to the originator or to the previous person in the workflow stage. And you click query, and it lets you put some information in here, like we don't deal with Windows, talk to maintenance. Is that the kind of window that you're talking about? And you put a question in there, and that will go automatically be sent to the previous role, or in this case, it's going to be back to the originator again. They can see the list of comments at the bottom in the comments tab, and they then get an option to click on respond right here. And they can say, I mean Windows on the PC. And that will then go back and it can continue basically off from where it was before. So it's a little way to have a conversation between you and other people involved in the workflow, and every part of your conversation is added to your comment list at the bottom. So that's very, very convenient, very easy to use and set up option in the workflow. But you don't have to, if you want it to work a little differently, you don't have to have that on. So you can turn it off and actually add the query and response in yourself. It's not very hard to do. Just a couple of extra stages in the workflow. The last option to mention is repeatable, and what this talks about, this refers to, sorry, is really for updating workflow. So you see right here we have a workflow type of creates new item. We can also have updates existing item. Now that basically means that if you click on an existing ticket, I can have a different workflow that goes on in parallel to this, and there'll be other buttons that show up over here. It can go on at the same time, allowing me to actually update something on the ticket. Nothing to do with the workflow I just created. It could be a different workflow entirely. So for that type of workflow, you'll say updates existing item. And repeatable just means that when that workflow is finished, should I be able to then run it again? For certain types of workflow, you do want to be able to run it again. For other types of workflow, not necessarily. Maybe, you only want to run it through once, and when it's finished, you don't want to see those buttons anymore. Okay, so that went. That's just let me let has let me take me. Sorry, that's let me take you through the different options that are available when you're creating a workflow, and that kind of explains a little bit some of the extra things that you see on here, like why there's no plus, and what this dropdown refers to right here. Okay, I think that's a pretty good intro. Actually, no, there was one other thing I wanted to mention. When you are logged in as a user, by default you don't get to see any other users other than your own user record. Now that can be problematic if you're showing a drop-down list of users. For example, let me just go to the users and I'll create a user in here. So let's say test user, and we'll just put this in. And we won't give him any roles. He'll be a new user. Okay, we don't have the email set up in here, but we basically have the user set up here, and we can update the password. Okay. So now let me just sign out of this, and we'll log in as test. Okay, so if I click on users now, it takes me straight to my user called test. I cannot see any other users that are in the system. If I go to, let me see. I cannot also add access any of the tech role buttons here because I don't have that particular role set up. So this can be problematic because, let me go back in as admin again. This can be problematic because when you're escalating it, this assigned to list shows you all of your users, but if you can only see one user, you're only going to see yourself in there, and that's not very useful if you want to escalate it to someone else. So when that happens, we need to actually edit the field and change some settings on the field. And that's what we're going to be doing in the next video, where we're going to show you how you can actually edit the field, and it opens up a whole new list of options that you can actually define on each of these fields.